Okay, hello everyone and welcome to my thesis presentation. The title of my thesis is Factors Influencing Capture Success and Prey Profitability in Australasian Gannets. So capture success and prey profitability are both related to foraging behavior, and foraging behavior is an important part in the life history of all animals. And several theories suggest that animals will try to optimize their foraging efficiency, as this will lead to more food uptake and a higher reproductive success in the end. So one of the measures of foraging efficiency is profitability, and this can be calculated as the energy gain minus the cost of foraging over the time. And for time, several factors can be taken into account, such as search time, chase time, which is mainly in predators, and also food handling time. And if an animal wants to increase its profitability, it will have to either target prey with a high energy content to increase the gain, or reduce the foraging time by, for example, looking for easy to find prey. So foraging behavior in seabirds. So seabirds forage in a habitat that's highly unpredictable in both space and time, which makes it a bit complicated for them to forage. They are also often top predators in the area where they occur, and they are central place foragers, so they always have to return to their nest to feed their chick and to let their partner depart for foraging. Foraging in seabirds is quite difficult to study because they forage in unpredictable places, but recently the use of technology such as GPS, GLS, accelerometers, and also bird-borne cameras allows to study the foraging in seabirds in more detail. So the study species in my thesis was the Australasian gannet. This one occurs around Tasmania, southeastern coast of Australia, and also around New Zealand in breeding colonies. They are an important marine predator in their range, and they are also often observed to forage with conspecifics and heterospecifics. And previous research in Cape gannets has suggested that they use these con and heterospecifics as a cue to locate their food. Further on, they are a visual predator, so all prey has to be located on sight. And when they find a prey, they are plunge diving, in which they dive from a great height into the sea at high speed to capture their prey. And if sometimes when the prey is escaping, they can chase the prey a bit by underwater ring beats. In the studied colonies, the Australasian gannets are also sexually dimorphic, with the females being larger than males. And in Bass Strait, the area of study, which you can see here, there are several colonies around the coast of Tasmania and along the southeastern coast of Australia. And these are the two study colonies, so Point Danger colony here and Pope's Eye colony over here. And Bass Strait is an area that's really vulnerable to climate change. It's one of the fastest changing regions worldwide. And this is expected to lead to shifts in species distributions of prey species, which can affect the foraging behavior of the gannets. Further on, the gannets at the Pope's Eye colony over here have been observed to adopt different foraging strategies. So some birds are foraging inshore over here in Port Phillip Bay in shallow water, and other birds are foraging in the pelagic area more over here. And almost all inshore foraging birds are males, but not all males do this, so it's not clear why they adopt this strategy. So the aims of this thesis were to identify the factors influencing capture success, as this is an important part of the foraging efficiency, and identify the factors influencing chase and handling duration, as this will influence the cost of foraging, and identify the factors influencing prey profitability. So data collection. So as I already said, data was collected in the Point Danger colony and in the Pope's Eye colony. So birds were caught at the colonies by hand or with a pole, and then a camera and GPS was deployed on their tail. You can see it over here. And the birds were left free, and then the following day the birds were recaptured to recover the camera and the GPS unit. This was done in four breeding seasons, And in the first breeding season, the cameras filmed continuously, but this gave problems as the bird didn't depart immediately from the colony. You didn't have any data of foraging. So for this reason, in later seasons, the cameras filmed for 30 minutes on, 90 minutes off cycles. And upon capture, sex and body mass was determined. And in total, we had 95 individuals which returned with usable camera data, of which 53 males, 40 females, and 2 unknown birds where the sex went a bit lost. Then the video analysis. So all videos were analyzed in a program called Solomon Coder. You can see a screenshot of it over there. And this program allowed to analyze the important parts of the videos frame by frame, not to miss anything. And then for the whole video, the foraging behavior was noted. So flying, gliding, diving. And at every dive, so every time they were catching prey, the chase time was determined, which started when the bird hit the water and stopped when the bird caught prey or gave up. And also the handling time, which started at prey capture and stopped when the last sign of the prey was observed. Conspecifics and heterospecifics were also identified at each foraging event. And these were lumped in different associations because there were like too much different combinations. And the associations we had were solitary foraging, foraging with dolphins, foraging with birds that were not gannets, foraging with conspecifics, and foraging in multi-species groups that contained combinations of conspecifics, dolphins, fur seals, and some other animals. Then the prey type was also determined when the prey was clearly visible. This could be determined, with a fish guide. And when the prey, the school or the individual fish was seen in the video, prey density index was also determined. And for this, a frame was drawn around from 2 fish lengths wide and 2 fish lengths high. This was drawn on the school for several screenshots, and the fish inside this frame were counted to determine the prey density. And we also determined if the prey was, if the dive was successful, unsuccessful, or had an unknown outcome. Okay, then for data analysis. So to account for repeated measures, mixed models were used, and the individual was put as a random factor in the model. To determine the factors influencing success, a binomially distributed generalized linear mixed model was used. And this model contained the possible factors habitat, association, sex, and mass nested with insects to account for the dimorphism of the gannets. Then for profitability, chase, and handling duration, a linear mixed effects model was used. And this contained the factors from the success model plus prey type and prey density. Then model selection was done, and models were sorted based on AIC value. And in the end, model averaging was applied for all models with an AIC lower than 4 to find the factors that were influencing success, chase time, handling time, and profitability. So the observed prey types, these were very similar to earlier studies, which were mainly based on regurgitations and isotope studies. So the main prey types were schooling species, such as red bait, anchovies, and also pilchard, which you can see on the top picture. And then some single prey species were also caught. These were barracuda, seen in the middle, a red mullet down there, and also some squids, but these were not as commonly observed as the schooling species. All schooling species were mainly caught in the pelagic area, while all, well, not, there were some schooling species in the inshore area, but really rare. And most of the single prey was caught in the inshore area. Then for the different foraging associations, so most popular was the solitary foraging. And then we also had from most abundant to least abundant conspecifics, multispecies, and small amounts of foraging with dolphins and birds. And you can see on the top picture, this is a multi-species association with conspecifics here. Here's some dolphins, and here 2 fur seals. In the inshore area, almost all birds were foraging solitary, while in the pelagic area, the conspecific and heterospecifics were more common, but there were also a lot of solitary dives, which can be explained by the fact that the birds, while they were approaching a feeding frenzy, often did like a dive without any conspecifics or heterospecifics nearby, but these were probably prey that escaped from the main bait bowl and got isolated. So for the factors influencing success, 594 successful dives were observed, 226 unsuccessful, and 211 unknown dives. The unknown dives mostly were really short, or the bill of the gannet was not really visible, so it couldn't be determined if it caught anything or not. The only factor influencing success was solitary foraging, where a lower chance of success was observed. As birds foraging inshore forage mostly solitary, this is probably associated to a lower chance of success, this strategy. But prey density and prey type were not included in this model because they were not observed in most unsuccessful dives. So, these are actually also expected to have an influence. For example, high prey densities can allow to catch a prey if the initial targeted prey is missed, or some prey types are maybe better at escaping the gannets. Then the factors influencing chase and handling duration. So in multi-species foraging, the chase time was observed to go up. This can be attributed to interference between the different predators and also competition. And you can see here a screenshot of a multi-species foraging. Like here you have a dolphin, here again, and then also the bird with the camera. So there's a lot of chaos going on, making it maybe more difficult to catch a prey. And then prey density was also observed to increase chase time, but it's not sure if this is either due to the fact that it's more difficult to target the prey because they are in a dense school, and it's not easy to focus on a single prey item, or maybe the fact that there's a lot of prey in a small area encourages the bird to chase for a longer time. Then for handling, the only prey type that was observed to increase handling time was barracuda. This was the largest prey type, so we think, as all small prey types were swallowed really quickly, that there was a relationship between prey size and handling time. And then prey density also increased handling time, but this was because gannets were diving deeper under high prey density, so it took them longer to get back to the surface. So for profitability, prey density and multi-species foraging were observed to decrease profitability because these increased chase and handling time. So profitability is divided by the time. Time increased, so profitability went down. And then for the prey species, all inshore prey species, being barracuda here, red mullet here, and also the squid, had a higher profitability than the pelagic prey species such as anchovy, pilchard, and redbait. So the profitability for habitat was also compared here: pelagic male, pelagic female, inshore male, and inshore female. And it can be seen that in the inshore habitat, the profitability is higher than in the pelagic habitat. And these females are a bit lower, but it's only a few observations, so maybe not completely accurate. Then in summary, so all factors seem to influence the handling, chase time, profitability, and success were related to the environment. So an effect of environmental change on the foraging is expected. As I already said, inshore foraging was more profitable, but due to a lower chance of success, it might be that there is some sort of trade-off between inshore and pelagic foraging. But previous studies showed that inshore the gannets do less dives, so maybe it's more profitable overall. But in this study, it was not possible to include the search time. So maybe search time is longer inshore than in the pelagic habitat, because inshore the birds can't really use heterospecific cues or conspecific cues to locate their food. So this is something that should be addressed in further studies. So, yeah, I want to thank Professor John Arnold for giving me the opportunity to do this thesis and for all of his support. I also want to thank the Coordination Office for giving me the opportunity to do this master's. And I also want to thank you guys for listening. So, are there any questions?